The sprawling Chesapeake Bay has more than 11,000 miles of shoreline and a watershed home to more than 18 million people. For decades, the interests and activities of those people have clashed with the well-being of the bay's abundant flora and fauna. Persistent pollution has decimated wildlife, and the bay has become a case study in ecosystem restoration. But restoration efforts started decades ago have fallen short. The root cause of the bay's problems? Nitrogen and phosphorus pouring into tributaries from farms, lawns, and polluted air. For years, mitigation of these pollutants was thought to be the only recourse. But in a surprising success story, a handful of scientists are beginning to restore some of the bay's keystone species today.
A long time ago, we know during the colonial period that this whole area was just blanketed with oyster reefs. And unfortunately, due to over-harvesting over two centuries, all that was lost. And we now have no more than 1 to 5% of the historical population remaining in the bay.
Working in Virginia, Lipsius, Seitz, and their collaborators have taken on the monumental task of reversing those trends. The key? Finding materials that the oysters love to glom onto and thrive on, whether old shells, artificial substrates like riprap, or concrete oyster castles.
So we're trying to assess the optimal shape of those reefs and spacing of those reefs and depth of those reefs so that we can get the maximum oyster settlement and proliferation of the oyster population.
Using a device called a hydrosurveyor, researchers were able to map the shallow oyster reefs in high resolution, a feat not possible with previous methods. This enabled them to find good sampling sites and chart the oyster's progress.
This the spot, Gabby, right here?
Yes.
So Gabby's using a GPS to take us to the exact spot that we need to sample.
We're going to basically use our hands to dig out the known area that we put down on the quadrat and put those all in here, and then we'll come back and count and measure everything that we have.
In addition to knowing exactly how many oysters there are per meter squared, we also need to know about their condition. We take a subset of these and we actually shuck them and weigh the meat. And that's one of the metrics that we use to find out how well a reef is doing, whether or not a reef that we've tried to restore is actually on its way to being restored. That might be.
Wow, Michelle, nice catch.
I got the winner.
Big oysters portend success. The larger they are, the more larvae they can send out. And the researchers have seen promising results thus far. But the oyster is not the only crucial bay species that has seen gains.
Seagrass is one of the key foundation habitats in the Chesapeake Bay and in shallow coastal marine systems worldwide. It provides refuge for small fishes, also for commercially important species like blue crab. It anchors the sediment, it clears the water, it allows small particles to settle down and become entrained. The first thing that you have to do to bring back seagrass is you have to remove the environmental stressors that caused it to collapse in the first place. When we have a eutrophied environment, and it's not just nitrogen, phosphorus also plays a role, we get blooms of algae in the water columns that's blocking light, and then we also will get increased growth of epiphytes. They're little algae growing directly on the seagrass leaves, and those can intercept a lot of light too. And so the combination of these things causes a lot of problems for seagrasses and other kinds of submersed aquatic vegetation.
In parts of the bay, seagrass has rebounded thanks to improved wastewater treatment plants that mitigate nutrient pollution. But Patrick and his team are aiming to speed up that rebound by taking on the painstaking task of actually planting seagrass seeds underwater.
This is the structure that the plant puts out around this time of year to actually produce seeds. And this is what we're harvesting, reproductive shoots like this, when we're collecting seeds in May.
Patrick is planting eelgrass and another species called widging grass that they hope will be robust enough to thrive. The first step is to harvest those seeds.
We let them all settle out. Then we go through a multi-step process of filtering and cleaning to separate them from the sediment. We do a variety of tests to see how good they are. We do sieving and we put them through flumes to separate better seeds from mid-grade seeds to worse seeds. And then we hold them in tanks until the fall when we plant them.
Patrick has had early success and hopes to see four times as much seagrass this year compared to his last survey. But as in the case of oysters, seagrass restoration is a daunting challenge. Gains will be hard won, and they won't solve the problem. Mitigating nutrient runoff into the bay continues to be crucial. Still, after decades of efforts to stem the damage, researchers are showing that they can lend the bay's key species a helping hand.